I'm here in the northern city of Taoyuan to see how Taiwan's first ever female reservists are training for combat.
Tapping into tech, a new push to speed up a free trade deal with India. Taiwan says it will do more to show the world it's a safe place to do business. Plus, no rain, no problem. Tea farmers figure out a way to grow their leaves in the middle of a drought. A warm welcome to TaiwanPlus News. I'm Betty Chen. Taiwan's first ever group of female reservists are training in the northern city of Taoyuan. Our reporter Jaime Okan is there to see them in action.
These soldiers are learning how to secure a park in Taiwan's northern city of Taoyuan. Among them are the country's very first group of female reservists. This particular group of women are veterans, and they are here to refresh their skills. These women will undergo the same training as their male counterparts. They will learn how to hold and secure a position, and how to defend against a biological attack. These are all skills all soldiers will need to master. Taiwan has an active military force of roughly 180,000, and 15% of that, or about 27,000, are women. However, Taiwan can mobilize, at least on paper, almost 2.3 million reservists to defend the country. This reservist training comes at a time when the country is facing an increased threat from China. And although military service isn't required for women, Taiwan has adjusted the length of its compulsory service. Taiwan recently extended its length of mandatory military service from 4 months to 1 year. It's all part of a push for the country to enhance its combat readiness. China sees Taiwan as part of its own territory and has threatened to invade the country to take full control. Officials here say that getting all soldiers ready is one of the first steps to boosting combat readiness. As Taiwan continues to bolster its defenses and further train its soldiers, officials here emphasize that safeguarding the country is a job for everyone, regardless of gender. Eason Chen and Jaime Okan in Taoyuan City for TaiwanPlus.
Taiwan's Trade Development Council has called for speeding up a free trade agreement with India. The South Asian country is one of the world's largest markets for electronic products, a key market for Taiwan's tech exporters. Joyce Zeng has more.
Information and communications tech, those are some of Taiwan's top exports. One of the largest markets for these products is India, now the world's most populous country after surpassing China earlier this year. As Washington and Beijing's battle for chip supremacy intensifies, numerous companies along the global supply chain are looking to mitigate risks, and the Indian market has emerged as a key opportunity. India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi has been pushing the Made in India and Digital India campaigns, eyeing his country's own chip-making ecosystem. Taiwan currently dominates the global market for advanced chip manufacturing. Still, the two countries appear to be finding areas to work together economically. Though Taiwan and India do not share official diplomatic relations, trade between the two jumped 185% between 2006 and 2021. And last year, Taiwan's exports to India reached $5.3 billion, a 17% rise from 2021 and the highest amount on record. That trend is set to continue.
I think we are in the most interesting time frame. And this 2023 will be written as a time for India-Taiwan investment push.
Taiwan has been working to remove barriers to trade and investment with India. But there have been a few hiccups along the road. To protect its local firms, India set up tariffs on Taiwan-made IT goods. but this was struck down by the World Trade Organization last month.
India lost over WTO, World Trade Organization lawsuit for the import tariff. That became a quite excitement because Taiwan won on that, and that creates a very definite picture that Taiwan seeing India as one of the most important partners.
Amid tense U.S.-China relations, more countries are looking to diversify their export markets and production bases to avoid any fallout. As for Taiwan and India, a common focus on tech could usher in a valuable new partnership. James Lin and Joyce Zhen for Taiwan Plus.
New Taipei City Mayor and potential presidential candidate Hou Yu-ih has rejected China's one-country, two-systems model that refers to a proposed mechanism to bring Taiwan under Chinese control.
Xi Jinping's 九二共识 is 一国两制. 市长您认同吗?
我反对一国两制.
Hou was responding to questions raised by city councillors from the ruling Democratic Progressive Party about his political viewpoints. Hou is a favorite presidential candidate for Taiwan's largest opposition party, the Kuomintang, or KMT. The KMT is often seen as China-friendly. While Hou says he views Taiwan as a separate sovereign country, he calls it by its official name, the Republic of China.
Taiwan is a sovereign and independent country, right?
没有错啊，中华民国宪法讲得非常的清楚啊。
是不是独立的国家？
当然台湾中华民国是一个主权独立的国家。
Taiwan's vice economy minister wants to reassure the world that Taiwan is safe. This follows Warren Buffett's sale of TSMC shares, citing geopolitical risks. Lin Chen-neng says the government will do more to show how safe Taiwan is. He also says they will step up efforts to help Taiwan's core industries improve their positions in global markets. Billionaire investor Buffett last week explained why his firm sold some TSMC shares. He praised TSMC's management and importance, but didn't like that it is located in Taiwan. Last month, Buffett also voiced concerns about a potential conflict between Taiwan and China. For more on Warren Buffett's comments on why he sold his stake in TSMC and the Taiwan government's response, TaiwanPlus reporter Jeremy Olivier spoke to Peter Kurz, Chief Strategy Officer at QIC International.
Would you say that Warren Buffett's recent remarks are an indication of overall investor sentiment regarding TSMC or of Taiwanese companies more broadly?
China has been increasing its threats of invading Taiwan over the past, you know, couple of years, and this is a reality we need to deal with. Now, it's really manifests itself, I think, more at the commercial level than at the investment level, meaning that most companies that I've spoken to, and with very few exceptions, have had their customers overseas ask them to start building facilities, manufacturing facilities, outside of China and Taiwan.
Do you expect that, you know, current geopolitical tensions, you know, will eventually lead to a trend of foreign divestment from Taiwanese businesses or Taiwan?
Certainly in the last decade or so, foreign direct investment hasn't been a significant driver to Taiwan economic growth. Now, foreign ownership of listed stocks in Taiwan has been quite substantial. It's been around about the sort of 40% level, plus or minus, for many years now. But as the companies themselves expand and diversify their manufacturing bases, and as the economy itself moves into these, again, more flexible, more virtual, or more data-oriented industries, Taiwan is already mitigating this risk. It's already becoming less focused on physical manufacturing, at least on the island itself.
What do you make of the vice economy minister's, you know, response to Buffett's remarks, you know, that the government, you know, put more effort into letting the world know that Taiwan is a safe place to invest?
Well, as is always the case, actions speak louder than words. And to simply say we are safe, don't worry, is not going to be that convincing. I think there needs to be more concrete steps taken and more evidence of that. But quite frankly, I think we need to also try as best as we can to defuse cross-strait tensions as well. And, you know, that's an issue well above my pay grade, but something I'd nonetheless like to see happen.
That was Peter Kurz, Chief Strategy Officer at QIC International, speaking with TaiwanPlus reporter Jeremy Olivier. Taiwan's central and southern regions are still facing drought conditions, even after the beginning of the rainy season brought heavy downpours over the weekend. Central Taiwan received the most rainfall, but the south of the country only saw sporadic rain, not enough to alleviate the overall drought. Reservoirs in the south were only slightly replenished. Authorities say more rain is needed to bring conditions back to normal. Taiwan is one of the largest tea consumers in the world, but with droughts occurring in central and southern parts of the country, some farmers have had to figure out new techniques to grow tea leaves. Bing Wang reports.
Green fields as far as the eye can see. This is Ding Sida's tea farm in central Taiwan's Nantou County. This year, central and southern Taiwan are experiencing severe drought. But even with the area running low on water, Ding is still able to grow his tea leaves. He says it's thanks to a new irrigation technique and a little bit of divine intervention. Ding spent 42 days during the winter season using his new method. Walking through the fields, he uses a hose to shoot water, fertilizer, and other ingredients into the soil every 30 centimeters. He then uses a method called drip irrigation to save water. In the past, tea farmers mostly used spray irrigation, using sprinklers to water their crops. But with that approach, much of the water lands on leaves and is blocked from reaching the soil. This in turn can cause the plant's roots to dry up. With drip irrigation, the water slowly penetrates the soil, strengthening the roots. It's also a water saver. Ding says the best time to use the system is during the winter. Taiwan is one of the largest tea consumers in the world. It's an industry that's grown massively in the last 40 years. In 1980, the average person in Taiwan consumed just under 350 grams of tea every year. But by 2020, that number rose to 1.7 kilograms. And with weather conditions proving challenging for the agricultural industry, many will be glad that tea farmers like Ding have found new ways to keep the country topped up with tea. John Su and Bing Wong for Taiwan Plus.
Taiwan Starlux Airline is facing an investigation from the Civil Aviation Authority over an incident that saw passengers stranded overnight at Tokyo's Narita Airport. Ed Moon has the story.
Starlux. It's a name that's taken Taiwan's airline industry by storm in recent months, rising to challenge the country's two other international carriers, China Airlines and EVA Air. But it's been far from turbulence-free for the newcomer. The airline is being investigated by Taiwan's Civil Aviation Authority over claims its flight crew were forced to work overtime. This comes after a recent spate of cancellations and delayed flights. In one case, hundreds of passengers were forced to sleep over in Tokyo's Narita Airport. It's just the latest in a long line of setbacks for the airline. Not long after launching, Starlux and the industry as a whole were rocked by the COVID-19 pandemic. And the company has struggled to get its hands on the aircraft it needs to scale up and take on its industry rivals. Currently, Starlux only has a fleet of 20 aircraft. That's far behind its rivals China Airlines, with 88 planes, and EVA Air, with 85. That means it can't compete in the number of destinations it flies to, and no spare planes are available when something goes wrong. One aviation official told TaiwanPlus that Starlux also appears to suffer from a shortage of manpower, with the company's owner helping out as a pilot, something that's very unusual in the industry. Taiwan's transport minister says it'll look into whether Starlux has the necessary resources to keep running its long-haul routes to North America.
还要继续扩充北美的这个航线，所以我们的想法是机师或是飞行组员够不够，飞机够不够，这个是决定它是不是继续扩充航线的一个基础了。The
airline industry is notoriously difficult to break into. With a huge capital outlay required upfront and many moving parts, airlines often fail before they truly get off the ground. The next few months will be crucial as Starlux looks to prove it's got staying power. Andy Sher, Sam Hui, and Ed Moon for Taiwan Plus.
Coming up, would you eat these fish sandwiches? Guess what? They're 3D printed. Details after the break.
Hello and welcome to Taiwan Talks. I'm Ian Cavatt.
This very aggressive form of cultural revolution-like politics in China seems to be moving forward in this modern era.
This grave injustice is happening.
I think Xi Jinping will not give up his ambition.
We need that kind of mindset to prepare for the warfare.
What implications does this have on Taiwan and the region as a whole?
Just like Ukraine right now, you need people to understand we're doing this for our own country.
Reaffirmed our support for the Taiwanese ability to make their own decisions about their own future.
It's very hard to duplicate in a short time. Taiwan still can continue being the leading position if we put efforts on R&D.
And you are riding on a wave. This is exactly the time you need to double down.
I did not realize I am actually running to be the first Asian woman in the state senate. Our next generation, they can see Asian American is as equal and have the same platform.
Taiwan Talks provides a platform for the voices and perspectives that are shaping our country.
Taiwan Talks, Monday to Thursday, 9 p.m. on Taiwan Plus.
Thank you for watching Taiwan Plus. For more stories from here in Taiwan and around the world, download the Taiwan Plus app.
Welcome back. You're watching TaiwanPlus News. China has expelled Canada's consul in Shanghai. The move is in apparent retaliation for Canada's decision to expel a Chinese diplomat. Ottawa says Zhao Wei conspired to intimidate members of parliament Michael Chong. Chong is an outspoken critic of China's treatment of its Uyghur minority. Zhao allegedly worked to gather information about Chong's relatives in Hong Kong. China's maritime militia sailed close to where the navies of India and some ASEAN nations were conducting joint drills in the South China Sea. Reports say the Chinese boats did not disrupt the exercises, which were the first of their kind between India and the Southeast Asian grouping. The South China Sea is seen as a possible flashpoint for a major conflict. Beijing claims most of it under its self-declared nine-dash line. Other countries also claim parts of it. The two-day drills ended Monday. For more, Taiwan Plus reporter Louise Watt spoke to Dr. Pooja Bhatt, a maritime analyst based in Delhi and author of the book Nine-Dash Line, Deciphering the South China Sea Conundrum.
Why are India and ASEAN holding their first joint exercises in the South China Sea now?
So as you're aware that India and ASEAN held their elevated their relationship to the strategic partnership, comprehensive partnership last year in 2022. So I think this these exercises are just coming to take a next step in the relationship. In that regards, we were expecting these exercises waiting to happen because India has already been holding these bilateral exercises with a lot of Southeast Asian countries, including Vietnam and Philippines. However, regional level exercises were due, and I'm glad that that has happened now. So I think it's a work in progress between the two sides, India and ASEAN.
How important is the South China Sea for India? I mean, are these exercises more a way of India expressing its displeasure at Beijing because relations between India and China haven't been so good over the past few years?
So these exercises in South China Sea is very important for India, and it's very from the viewpoint of national interest. If you see, India has its trade, over 55% of its trade passing through South China Sea. Most of our high trade partners are Japan, South Korea, even China. So for India, it's only reasonable to have the sea line of communications open and the trade routes quite clear and free of any threats of any kind, traditional and non-traditional. This is only a coincidence to say that India-China relationships are not going to the best of the times. However, at the same time, India is taking its relationship with the Southeast Asian countries really seriously. And then both of these sides have mutual interest in economic prosperity of the region. I think from that viewpoint, India and ASEAN is going ahead for these exercises to secure and safeguard the sea line of communications in the South China Sea.
Russia is marking Victory Day, the anniversary of the defeat of Nazi Germany in World War II. Speaking before a military parade, Russian President Vladimir Putin said his country is the victim of war.
Против нашей родины вновь развязана настоящая война. Но мы дали отпор международному терроризму, защитим и жителей Донбасса, обеспечим свою безопасность. Для нас, для России, нет ни дружественных, враждебных народов ни на Западе, ни на Востоке.
Putin also compared his invasion of Ukraine to the fight against the Nazis. He has used what he called Nazism in a country as justification for Russia's attack on its neighbor. Putin's speech follows overnight airstrikes against Kyiv. Taiwan's Environmental Protection Administration is set for an upgrade to a full government ministry. The legislature finalized a law to make the change on Tuesday and now awaits a sign-off from President Tsai Ing-wen. The new Ministry of Environment will have more powers than the old body. As well as environmental protection, one of its main tasks will be tackling the country's response to the climate crisis. Local environmentalist groups praised the move.
那等级也比较高，就是在政府的这些机关当中，这个层级也比较高，所以大体上来说，它会对于整个国家处理气候变迁这个项目有更多的人力跟可能比较多的资源一起来处理。American
Taiwanese writer Hua Shu has won a Pulitzer for his memoir Stay True. In this coming-of-age story, Shu captures his past through mid-1990s music and fax messages with his father in Taiwan. Shu also recounts a college friendship with an Asian-American boy who was killed in a carjacking. Columbia University awards Pulitzer Prizes to honor outstanding journalism, literature, and music from the United States. They are widely recognized as some of the most prestigious awards in these fields. This is Shu's second book and his first Pulitzer. He serves as a staff writer for the New Yorker magazine. You've heard about 3D printed objects, but what about 3D printed fish? A company is looking to make lab-grown fish an alternative food source to wild ones. Eric Gao has the details.
These aren't your normal fish fillets. They're not even your normal fish. These are 3D printed fish steaks made from lab-grown grouper cells. An Israeli company called Stakeholder Foods has come up with a way to make the meat feel as close as possible to the real thing.
With our patent-protected printing capabilities, we know to 3D print exactly the same texture and flakiness of a real fish. That's something that we have already a capability today of printing.
It may look like the real thing, but the big question is, how does it taste?
I can feel the same, almost the same experience of the fish structure in my mouth. And I'm also really amazed by the juiciness and also the kind of a buttery feel in my mouth.
For the fillets, Stakeholder grows muscle and fat cells in a lab. These cells are added into a sort of bio-ink that can be used with 3D printers. Because the process is still expensive, they add plant-based ingredients to fill out the bio-ink. So far, they've successfully replicated grouper and eel, but they're working on other fish species too.
We have three other species in our pipeline that are also endangered sort of species that we'll be coming out with publicly in the next few months. And the goal is to build a repository so that the same hardware can manufacture products from any of these cell lines.
Stakeholders has teamed up with Singapore-based Umami Meats to bring their products to Asia. Fish is a major source of protein for over a billion people in the region.
For us, it's high impact regionally, and I think more salient to a conversation about food sustainability.
For now, the 3D printed fish is more expensive than traditionally caught fish, but the companies say they're confident that as the technology matures, the price will come down and more people will be able to afford it.
We want consumers to choose based on how it tastes and what it can do for the world and for the planetary environment, and we want to take cost off the table as a consideration.
The companies hope to start selling their 3D printed fish steaks next year in Singapore before expanding to other countries. So, soon, these fabricated fillets could be available in a restaurant near you. Kama Shu and Eric Gao for Taiwan Plus.
Masters of two great operatic traditions have joined forces to bring a classic Chinese story to the stage. The piece Zhuge Liang, A Promise Never Forgotten, tells the tale of an ancient Chinese strategist and his son. The project brings together Taiwanese opera star Tang Meiyun and Peking opera master Tang Wenhua. They have found big differences between their respective genres, but created a work that unites both. Thank you for watching Taiwan Plus News. Finally today, we leave you with images of swimmers battling through cold temperatures in a race in Lake Titicaca. Located in the Andes Mountains, it's the world's highest navigable lake. I'm Betty Chen. Take care and see you next time.